I'm Prunella Scales.
And I'm Timothy West.
Beautiful.
We've been husband and wife for over 5 decades.
Amazing.
Cheers.
We've been wedded to stage and screen for even longer.
Great hair, Ruth.
But we share another passion. Canals.
Cast off, please.
Aye, sir.
Canals wind through our lives, carrying our treasured memories.
Of families growing up.
Of moments of wonder.
And hidden beauty.
Is this the most remote canal we've ever been on?
It probably is, yes.
Of love.
And laughter.
Sorry about that.
Things are a bit harder for me these days.
I'm not strong enough.
But we get by.
We're at the summit.
Hooray! Prue has a slight condition. It does mean she has difficulty remembering things.
Oh, my darling, I'm so sorry. I didn't cast you off.
One has to recognise that Prue's domestic life is getting a little narrower by the day.
Well, it can be a nuisance, but it doesn't stop me remembering how to open a locked gate or make the skipper a cup of tea.
OK, cast off.
OK.
This time, we'll explore new countries.
Rialto, of course.
Make new memories.
I mean, this is canal perfection, isn't it?
And return to old haunts.
Hello, I remember you.
Yeah, about a year ago, wasn't it?
Yeah.
But one thing stays the same.
We're always together.
Let's stay right here. So peaceful.
Probably.
Maps.
As actors, one or other of us is always packing to go away, either on tour or to a film set.
Which hat do you think?
And we've not had the time for as many romantic trips away together as I'd have liked.
I'll bring them all.
And don't forget your handbag.
And every marriage needs a little romance.
Even after 53 years?
Especially after 53 years.
So, we're embarking on a voyage to one of the world's most romantic destinations, Venice.
Unbelievable.
Founded 15 centuries ago from a cluster of malaria-infested mud flats, the city rose to become Europe's richest trading empire.
Not what we have in England, is it? Old mills and a pub if you're lucky.
Yeah.
Tourists flock here, drawn to its opulence and its beauty.
Far too many people.
Yes, too many actors.
Yes.
No director.
But it's the city's relationship with its canals that really sets it apart.
So we're going to experience Venice at water level. Exploring the veins and arteries of a living city.
It's a lot busier than British canals, isn't it?
Yeah, the boats move quicker too.
Oh, look out. We're going to hit that boat coming towards us.
I think we're stuck.
Oh.
It's certainly not the kind of canal journey we're used to.
Oh, God.
We've got a packed schedule.
La donna è mobile.
We're going this way.
Yeah.
Soy el Capitán Cardón, destruidor de Castillo.
But there should still be a little time for each other.
We start our journey 14 miles west of Venice, on the Brenta Canal. First canalized in the 13th century, in the Renaissance period, the canal became a fashionable place for noble Venetian families to spend the summer.
And its banks are lined with their great villas and palaces.
We'll be following the same route the Venetian nobility took when they returned to Venice after their hulls.
Yes, that's all right. A penny shed, isn't it?
Okay. Probably just about. Eccellente.
Right, in you go.
Wow, very luxurious.
Pretty nice, isn't it?
Yeah. Didn't the Venetian nobles used to come on this canal?
Yes, they did, absolutely. at the end of their summer holidays, and they'd have travelled in very magnificent boats called Borchiellos, full of velvet and gold leaf and so on.
Don't suppose they had a fridge, though. Oh.
I think we ought to get on.
All right. Later.
OK, cast off. All right?
Yep, fine.
We're off. Right. Venice, here we come.
The city of lovers.
Yes. And canals, of course.
You love canals more than me.
When you're ready.
We start on the Italian mainland, at Dolo. We'll pass the sumptuous summer houses of well-heeled Venetians, travelling east to the port of Fusina.
Then we'll cross the lagoon to the main island of Venice, mooring in the heart of the city.
And transferring to a smaller vessel, we'll weave our way through its narrow canals.
Finally, we'll head north across the lagoon again to the island where Venice began.
It may be three centuries since Venetian nobles sailed the Brenta, but some things, like traditional rowing, haven't changed.
Very quiet canal, isn't it?
Yes. Weeping willows. Lovely willows. Cheer up, willows. Nothing to cry about. Are you allowed to have some wine at the wheel?
Certainly, yes. It's a boat.
As the Venetians say, for every 4 kilometres of canal, you need 1 litre of wine.
How very sensible. Lining the Brenta Canal are reminders of Venice's prosperous past, when, despite beginning life as a small European city-state, it grew to become one of the wealthiest places in the world.
A lot of people built very elegant villas. Well, that's quite elegant.
Wow! Palaces beside a canal. It's not what we have in England, is it?
Not quite.
Old mills and a pub if you're lucky.
Yeah.
Today, a few of them are for rent, if you've got the money. And it's not just the canal-side properties that are grand. Some of the passengers on the Brenta were pretty high class, too.
Dante, Casanova.
Good Lord.
Byron.
Imagine being on a boat with Lord Byron and Casanova.
You'd have a busy time.
Which would I yield to first, do you think?
Well, you're a bit of a snob. Go on. Lord Byron, go for it.
Ahead lies an elegant Palladian villa owned by the Foscari family, whose most illustrious ancestor became the Doge of Venice in 1423. It's also famous for the tragic life of one of its occupants, hence its name, Villa Foscari Malcontenta.
Which of the wives was Malcontenta?
Why do you assume it was one of the wives?
Because of Malcontenta.
Well, she was.
Malcontento.
She was very malcontent about being shut away because she had committed considerable indiscretion.
The allegedly promiscuous Malcontenta is said to haunt the villa.
Oh, right. Buongiorno.
Buongiorno. Ben arrivati.
How was your journey?
Local historian Christina knows the tragic tale.
We have a phantom here. It's Lady Elisabetta Dolphin. She was the wife of Niccolò Foscari, and she misbehaved. Can I say that?
Yes, she loved men, but
she was married, and that was no good.
So he
locked her in for about 30 years, and people say that...
Years.
Yes, isn't that
she
awful?
Lost her.
She was locked in for 30 years.
Yes.
The villa is an architectural gem, designed by Andrea Palladio himself, whose work influenced countless English stately homes.
Our host, Professor Foscari, is a descendant of the original owners.
Ah! Beautiful. Beautiful.
It is monumental.
Perché l'architettura di Palladio è molto severa, come fuori solo il cotto dei mattoni e il bianco, quindi anche dentro era bianco il colore del cotto anche del pavimento.
You see the floor, it's still the original color. And Palladio, he liked white and this white, brownish, yes, color, yes. So he liked simplicity. Color, yes. Professor believes Palladio wouldn't have wanted all these frescoes. That's way too overwhelming for Palladio's style.
They do actually obscure the shape of the ceiling slightly, and therefore I can see that he would perhaps not be very pleased.
You're absolutely right.
It's quite special for a holiday home.
Che bella vista!
Professor, do you yourself live here some of the time?
More in summer, because in winter we have fireplaces, but it's not so easy to have sufficient heating for my wife.
Yes, enough said.
Now, the room where the Malcontenta was imprisoned.
May I introduce you to
Elisabetta
Dolfin, La Malcontenta.
La Malcontenta.
There she is.
Si capisce che è una giovane sposa per le perle.
You understand that she's a young bride by the necklace, by the pearls. She was locked in this half of the house for about 30 years.
Poor lady.
Elisabetta was unlucky to have been locked up for having an affair, because back then it was quite the done thing for a Venetian wife to take a lover.
Well, apparently you could have, in addition to your husband, one lover, called a cicisbei.
A cicisbei,
an extra friend.
Would you allow me a lover or two if we were Venetian?
It would depend. No, he would have to be very, very handsome.
Well, I won't do it, I promise.
Okay.
It's now just half a mile to the Venetian Lagoon.
We are getting to the end of the canal.
Will we see the sea in a minute?
Yes, we shall. Yes, this is coming to it now. Just past this last lot of cranes.
I can't see it yet. I think I'm not tall enough. Story of my life.
Prue's always been charmingly self-deprecating, but I do worry that she's starting to lose her confidence. That's why these sort of trips have become so important. And I'm hoping Venice, a place we visited together many years before her condition took hold, will bring back happy memories.
See that amazing channel at the end is Venice. But there it is.
It's exciting to be going there. I haven't been there for years and years and years.
Look at it. Looks extraordinary, doesn't it? It looks unreal.
Voyage to Venice. Today we'll cross the lagoon heading for the heart of the city.
Would you cast off?
Easier said than done.
Tell me when you're off.
Okay, we're off.
Are we off?
Yeah.
Right. Prue?
Hello,
happy come, love. La Serenissima, here we come.
Leaving the mainland behind, we'll pass Venice's outlying islands before taking the Giudecca Canal south to St. Mark's Square. Transferring to a smaller boat, we'll navigate through the city's canals to Venice's famous opera house, La Fenice.
So we're taking the route that the first settlers in Venice took 1,500 years ago. They were refugees from the barbarians in the north and settled in the marshlands of what became Venice.
So a city built on fear and flight became one of the most beautiful cities in the world.
Exactly, yeah.
Amazing.
Although we're not being pursued by the likes of Attila the Hun today, these are still deceptively hazardous waters. And we must stick to the narrow navigation channel.
Now we can see The city of Venice emerging out of the mist.
Yes.
Wow.
Very beautiful.
It's a city of imagination, isn't it?
Oh yes, inspired countless poets.
Including the great English romantic Lord Byron, who arrived in 1816, drawn to La Serenissima, the most serene city. Fresh from ocean, rising with her tiara of proud towers, at airy distance, with majestic motion, a ruler of the waters and their powers.
Fine words. But clearly, Byron never had to moor his boat at St. Mark's. It would be easier to park a car at Piccadilly Circus.
About five boats all trying to get in. Jam-packed, isn't it? I don't know he's coming out. Can we get in there?
Charming.
Patience, darling.
Could you get in to the left of the one on the... No, you couldn't quite.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know.
No, I don't think so.
Nobody takes any notice.
Thank goodness for that. Oh. We've arrived at last in St. Mark's Square, a symbol of Venice's once great power.
I love it. Piazza San Marco.
Yeah. It's amazing.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Starting out as marshy island dwellers, the Venetians used their mastery over water to establish the greatest maritime trading empire in history. For over 1,000 years, this city was Europe's gateway to the East.
First time you see a Venetian, tell me.
It's like an enormous stage. Far too many people.
Yes, yes, too many actors.
Yes.
No director in view. Fancy some coffee?
Yeah.
In the 18th century, the city boasted a mere 200 cafes, with 24 vying for business on St. Mark's Square alone. Today, there are just 5, and one of them has claimed to be the oldest coffee house in Europe.
Cafe Florian. Been serving coffee since before you were born.
When was that?
Oh, 1720.
Oh, charming. Yeah. Thank you very much. Buongiorno. Buongiorno.
Hello.
Hello.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to
Welcome to Cafe Florian.
We're joined by Anna Rita, who's a manager here.
Would you like to have something to drink? Cafe Florian is very famous for hot chocolate and, of course, coffee.
Hot chocolate, perhaps. Yes, because it's
like
something that we never have at home.
Venice was the first town that imported coffee. And, of course, here they've been serving coffee for 300 years.
It's thanks to the merchants of Venice that we can enjoy a coffee break today. Trading with the Ottomans in the early 17th century, they brought coffee beans to Europe for the very first time.
And I suppose that's why we now think of coffee as the quintessentially Italian drink.
Cafe and naughty bickies.
In the 18th century, caffeine and coffee houses like this one fueled artistic creativity like never before.
Same time as Venice, it was falling down economically, it was growing
Absolutely.
Culturally, wasn't it?
Yes, yeah. That's the point. They stopped going around the world and they concentrated on culture and yeah. beautiful things.
By the 1700s, Venice was no longer an imperial power. And transformed itself into a seductive haven dedicated to art and pleasure.
Many a young toff on his grand tour was lured to the city, hoping to emulate the exploits of the infamous Venetian womanizer, Giacomo Casanova.
Lovely.
The legend says Casanova used to come here and have hot chocolate because it's aphrodisiac.
That must have had a particular attraction for Lord Byron.
We say, oh, this is the sofa Lord Byron preferred to meet women.
Yes.
Time to explore.
But we'll leave the flashy gondolas to the tourists and travel the city's canals the Venetian way.
Marco, hi.
Marco.
Aboard a traditional working boat, a torpetta.
It's small and very wobbly.
Okay. Yeah. Fantastic.
So, how many people fall over when they come aboard?
Well, quite a lot, but we're good. So have a seat down there, Prue.
Grazie.
Oh, okay.
Okay, no way.
Have a nice trip.
Thank you. Grazie.
Canals are the original streets of the city. It's how Venetians have been going about their business for centuries.
It's a lot busier than British canals, isn't it?
True, but this is rush hour on the Grand Canal, and they're all Italian.
What do I do to crew?
Just keep a lookout and see if there's anything behind us, will you? Because I can't see or hear.
There's nothing behind us at the moment. Oh, look out.
Yep.
We're going to hit that boat coming towards us. I'm scared out of my socks.
I'm trying to put on a brave face for Prue, but this is all rather alarming.
Right.
Okay, well done.
With relief, we turn off the Grand Canal and go in search of our first destination, La Fenice, the world-famous opera house.
And it feels like we've entered a different world.
Amazing.
You all right? You were looking a bit pained and anxious earlier.
I was.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Canals here are totally different from canals in Britain because we form canals by making a cut, aren't we, through the terrain.
Venice was once just a series of marshy islands, and many of its canals were originally the streams and channels that ran between them.
So there are 170 of them altogether, threading their way through the city.
We just have to choose the right one.
Yes, I hope we have. I hope we have.
I'm struggling to find the theatre. It's a while since I last came here. 45 years, in fact. In 1971, I played King Lear here for the very first time. A part I've performed a number of times since.
Getting to the stage door is turning into quite a performance in itself.
Touch your head. Are we stuck?
What?
I think we're stuck.
Oh, want me to push you off?
Okay.
This is the only theatre in the world where both cast and scenery have to access the stage door by water.
Oh, fart. This is impossible.
What?
Good job you're not on tonight, then. I'm not sure you'd make the curtain call.
Va bene,
grazie. Oh, that was a balls up.
Wow.
All by water, yeah.
Things have changed since I played here, as tragically in 1996, this building was virtually burnt to the ground. La Fenice had to be completely rebuilt.
It took 2 years and 90 million euros to recreate the opera house's mid-19th century heyday.
Wonderful to be back.
What do you think, Prue?
It's incredible, the detail.
During that period, Venice enjoyed artistic freedom like no other city in Italy. And at its heart was La Fenice. We're joined by its artistic director, Fortunato Ottombini.
It was possible for Verdi to premiere here in Venice pieces that he would have never been allowed to premiere in Milano. For example, Rigoletto was premiered here. La Traviata was premiered here. They were too modern. Can you imagine in the 19th century to have a subject where you put the prostitution on stage? So, not only Verdi, but before Donizetti, Rossini, Bellini, everybody wanted to compose a piece in La Fenice.
Verdi wrote and rehearsed Rigoletto in secret. ready for its world premiere at La Fenice in the spring of 1851.
You know that in Rigoletto you have La Donna Immobile.
Yeah.
La Donna Immobile, qual piuma al vento. He wanted that this was a surprise, so that nobody knew the piece before the premiere. When he came to the theater the night of the premiere on a gondola, the gondoliers in leading him to the theater, la 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 la. So, and he was absolutely disappointed.
Oh, yes.
it sounds wonderful, echoing backwards and forwards.
Yeah.
It's magic.
The sound you have in the canal, this is absolutely, absolutely unique.
Ponte Teta. Watch out for your Teta.
Timmy, do you know where we are?
What? Well, yes, darling, of course I do. Absolutely.
We're lost, aren't we?
Maybe a little bit lost.
We're on a canal journey through Venice. They do canals a little differently over here, and instead of spending the night on a towpath mooring, our Venetian digs,
Homies,
are a canal-side palazzo.
Pretty good, isn't it?
Oh, brilliant. Brilliant.
London has the Mall, New York has Broadway, Paris has the Champs-Élysées, and Venice has the Grand Canal.
It's all very romantic.
Like a second honeymoon.
First one not good enough, eh? What's wrong with a week in North Wales? Today, we'll be travelling along the city's main waterway to the ancient Rialto Market.
Heading away from the tourist hotspots, we'll meet a master of traditional Venetian theatre.
And finally, a nighttime voyage aboard the quintessential Venetian vessel, the gondola. The 2 mile Grand Canal has been the city's main thoroughfare since Venice was founded. This morning, we're following it north to the Rialto Market, which has been in operation for over 9 centuries.
Door to door by canal boat. You can't beat that.
It's our kind of city. Oh, shall we move here?
It's a bit of a business. Very lovely, though.
I know.
I think I could cope with it.
Could you keep a narrow boat on the canals in Venice?
Not sure.
What's that bridge called?
The Rialto.
The Rialto, si. Of course, yes.
Until 1854, this was the only bridge across the Grand Canal. Back then, to get around, you had to have a boat.
You're doing very well, darling. You haven't bumped into anything yet.
Not yet, no. Or been shouted at yet.
The whole Rialto area was once the commercial hub of the Venetian Republic. Back in the 16th century, this was the bazaar of Europe, an enticing marketplace where you could buy or sell anything. Luxurious fabrics, precious stones, or exotic spices. Parts of it are still in operation, the same as they were 500 years ago.
This is the ancient fish market.
Oh, right.
Been here since 1514, I think. Having played an ex-Billingsgate fish porter.
Yes.
I can recognise the smell.
It might smell like Stan Carter's East End, but with barely a tourist in sight, it feels like we might have found a corner of actual Venetian life.
La pescheria.
Yeah.
This is as much traditional Venice as St. Mark's or the Rialto Bridge,
yes,
isn't it?
Yes, it is,
really?
Yes. Yeah. And don't forget, all the fish comes in
by canal.
Brilliant. They're alive.
Well...
Yes, look, they're ish. Moving there.
Yes, yes.
Mm. Oh, la la. Oh, poor darlings.
Venice is not just a tourist destination. It's still a living city.
And our next port of call is another authentically Venetian area, Canareggio, where we'll meet an actor known for his mastery of commedia dell'arte.
Must be dodgy hanging out your washing there.
Venice has been working its magic on Prue, bringing back all sorts of memories.
Titi titi, piano piano, non facciamo confusione, della scuola del balcone, andiamo presto via di qua.
Bravo, bravo.
Who'd have thought she could remember the libretto from The Barber of Seville? And in very good Italian.
No time for an encore, though. Actor Alessandro Bressanello is waiting.
As we say here, salute.
Salute.
Salute. It's wonderful to be here and
wonderful.
And to meet people who are in our business.
I've been working all my life on commedia dell'arte. Called commedia dell'arte because arte in Italian means work. Yes. So it was the first professional theatre, you know, in the world.
That's what we like to hear. Actors getting paid for their art.
And no women, no actresses.
Sure, sure. It's the first theatre that used women.
Uh-huh.
And it was a scandal at that time. That's why the church didn't allow to bury the actors in a cemetery. They had to be buried outside because it was a scandal.
Emerging in Renaissance Venice, commedia dell'arte is a form of improvised theatre featuring familiar characters like Harlequin and Pantalone.
Its influence can be seen in everything from Shakespeare to Charlie Chaplin and even Mr. Bean.
We have just stock characters, you know, with 10, 12 maximum characters.
Yes.
They used to have what we call scenario, which is the plot. Mm-hmm. So from these couple lines, the actors should improvise. We can go just nearby. There's an atelier of costumes where I can show you my mask. Maybe we do something. We have some
wonderful.
Fun.
Wonderful, thank some you. Fun. Are you finishing it?
Don't get drunk before start to play. Okay, we go this way.
Please.
Ciao.
Alessandro takes us to a local costumier and with the help of his friend Stefano, introduces us to a couple of his favorite commedia characters.
Hello, nice good to meet you.
Buongiorno.
Hello, buongiorno.
Wonderful place.
Benvenuti.
Wonderful place.
There's the cowardly Il Capitano.
Io sono il Capitan Cardone.
Oh, good.
And the greedy nobleman, Pantalone.
Finally, this is Arlecchino, or Harlequin.
The servant is very rude, is stupid.
Yeah. Ha, he reminds me of a Spanish waiter I once knew.
Andiamo a far due passi.
No, stop it, stop it, stop it.
No, please,
oh,
master.
Rubbish.
E questa bella giovine.
Visiting a fellow actor has taken us deep into the backwaters of Venice, perhaps not always the most salubrious part of town.
No two bridges are the same, are they? Now ahead of us is the Ponte del Tetto.
Mm-hmm. What does that mean?
What do you think?
Is it?
It was where the ladies of the night used to stand up and
brandish there.
Brandish their wares for the passing boaters.
Just can't take him anywhere.
Venice is renowned as the City of Lovers, thanks to the exploits of Casanova and Lord Byron. They both discovered the city possesses a powerful tool for seduction. I wonder if it works even after 50-odd years of marriage.
We're going in a gondola for a ride.
Most Venetians wouldn't be seen dead in a gondola, but then we're not Venetians, are we?
No, absolutely not. We're actors. Oh, beautiful.
Passano sul mar de gondole, placide tra i sogni d'or, Venezia e la luna e tu.
It is lovely being at water level, actually.
Glorious.
Di cuor ci parlerà, Venezia e la luna e tu.
A full moon?
Yes.
In a gondola?
Yes.
On the canals in Venice.
Imagine,
you do give me a romantic time.
Well, it's worked. Casanova, Lord Byron, and now Timothy West.
It's early morning in this uniquely beautiful and serene city, and already the tourists start to throng the streets.
But I wonder how many of them know the secret behind the city's soaring spires and elegant squares. Today, we'll discover the key to the power and success of Venice.
We're going to have quite a long trip today. You up for that?
Yes.
I want to go to the Arsenale, the arsenal of Venice,
right,
which was the source of their great power, militarily and, more important, naval power.
Yes. Will we have time for lunch first?
Maybe not first, but we'll certainly have time for lunch. Right, shall we go?
Threading our way through Venice's back street canals, we'll then skirt the edge of the city to visit the Arsenale. Heading across the lagoon, we'll pick up a traditional rowing vessel before ending our journey on the island where Venice began.
We love exploring the watery underbelly of Venice.
But I still keep running into trouble. Seems you have to be born here to understand the rules.
Yes, I'm just going to let him go first. It's Venetian rush hour. But then I think it always is.
When there's an emergency in Venice...
Coming at such a pace. My God.
Of course, it's a boat that comes to the rescue.
Well, my word, that was close.
Coming to the lagoon now, you can see a boat passing by.
Batten down the hatches.
To reach the Arsenale, we have to skirt the edge of the city, which means braving rough open waters.
I like 4 miles an hour on our own canal best, I think.
Yeah, it's not like this in Banbury.
Fortunately for Prue, I can now see the Arsenale's Porta Nuova gates. Of course, by new port, we're talking the early 1300s.
Quite impressive, isn't it?
Yes.
Enormous gates.
It was here that they built the ships that once ruled the waves of the Mediterranean. 16,000 men once slaved away in the Arsenale. Known as La Machina, the machine, it inspired Dante in his portrayal of one of the eight circles of hell. As in the Arsenale of the Venetians, boils the tenacious pitch. One hammers at the prow, one at the stern. This one makes oars, and that one cordage twists. Another mends the mainsail and the mizzen.
Welcome. I would like to show you first the...
Historian Martino Rizzi knows the important role the Arsenale played in the story of Venice.
This was the oldest shipyard in the world.
He was active for 7 centuries. Yes, from the mid-12th century until the First World War.
You had skilled people doing every
absolutely,
job.
Absolutely,
carpenters,
absolutely.
Sailmakers.
Sailmakers, rope makers. Yeah, yeah. Imagine in 1500 they rebuilt the rope factory. Yeah. 317 meters long building to have long ropes.
Yes.
Here was the first factory in the Western world, and here they invented a sort of assembly line. Centuries before Mr. Ford.
Yeah.
Centuries and centuries. This was a factory made to build galleys. Galleys were the very fast, very safe, huge ships.
With up to 200 oarsmen, the Venetian galley was fast and maneuverable. Good for both trade and battle, they helped Venice to dominate the Mediterranean for over 200 years.
You have the very origin of Venice, of the myth of Venice. Yeah. The maritime power who could rule over more than half of the Mediterranean Sea, the richest republic. Without these buildings, without the sheds to build the galleys, we wouldn't have the Doge's Palace or the Cadoro.
Mm.
Or who knows, maybe not even the Basilica St. Mark, but this is the very origin. And we are proud of the Arsenale. We are very proud of this building.
Yeah.
It's part of our history.
We're now heading to the outer Venetian islands, so we're back aboard our more seagoing vessel.
Hey, where are we off to?
We're off to Burano, first of all, across the lagoon, and then we're going to be rowed, I think by two ladies, to Torcello.
Remind me about Torcello.
Torcello is very, very beautiful. It's the birthplace of the Venetian Republic, in fact. It's where it all started. Very, very few occupants, but very, very beautiful.
The lagoon hasn't seen Venetian galleys for several centuries. But there is a rowing boat still in use today, whose origins go back to the foundations of Venice. The last leg of our voyage will be aboard a flat-bottomed Pulparino.
So this must be Burano. It's bigger than I remember it. Wonderful colour buildings, aren't they? The oranges and the yellows. Come on, Pruitt. Yep.
At the Burano Rowing Club, they race traditionally designed boats, ones that would not be unfamiliar to the first Venetian settlers.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
Nice to meet you.
Since at least the 15th century, women as well as men have competed in regattas.
At least also races.
Yes.
Yeah, I raced in this boat last year and I came fourth.
Came fourth?
Oh, in, yeah. Felicità.
Grazie, thank you.
In the world? Fourth
in Venice.
In Venice,
yeah.
Well,
it's only in Venice that we're racing Pulparino. Yes.
Rowing goes to the heart of the Venetian identity. It's with the oar that they escaped from the invading barbarians over 1,000 years ago. And they're as passionate about rowing as other Italians are about football.
Elisa and Jane will row us across the channel to the island of Torcello.
It's brilliant, isn't it? Do you remember when we had to lift our narrow boat out?
Oh, yes.
A few slings like that.
Came with me?
Right.
Okay. Oh, la, la.
Onto the boat and then down. Perfetto.
Gosh, we think our narrow boat at home can be a bit of a squeeze at times.
Nothing to hold on to, is there?
Yeah. Just the seat.
Yeah.
Perfect for fishing the shallow waters of the lagoon, the Pulparino was clearly not designed for transporting two rather nervy actors.
Goodbye in the unlikely event of our surviving it.
Voga alla Veneta, traditional Venetian rowing, is always performed facing forward and standing up to make it easier to spot the rocks and sandbanks in the shallow lagoon. In boats like this, settlers first hunted, fished, and made their homes on the marshy grounds of the lagoon 1,500 years ago.
Piano, piano.
We've made it to the safe waters of Torcello.
So we're now in, or on the island of Torcello.
We're on the island of Torcello. Yeah.
Torcello is the first island of Venice.
The early Venetians learned how to master this land of marsh and water, to live at one with the tides and the sea. And the skills they developed led them to create one of the most elegant and beautiful cities the world has ever known.
This is where it all started.
Oh.
Venice grew out of the water, and I suppose we'll go back into it again.
I think Lord Byron summed it up perfectly.
Oh, Venice, Venice, when thy marble walls are level with the water, there shall be a cry of nations o'er thy sunken halls.
Loud lament along the sweeping sea.
Next time, we're journeying through the Netherlands, a country created by its canals.
I mean, this is canal perfection, isn't it?
Amazing. Along the way, you'll get a flavor of old Amsterdam.
You can smell the marijuana.
I didn't recognize the smell. And admire the splendor of the Dutch Golden Age.
Well, taking veterinary procedure to a whole new level tomorrow night here on 4, going beyond the operating table with a Super Vet Bionic special. That's at 8. Stocks low, but demand is high next tonight, though. Britain's benefit tenants. Coming up.